Happy Father's Day, guys. Happy Father's Day.
Amen.
Good to see you, man.
Good to see you guys.
This side did say it's Saturday, so they did take baths. So, kind of looks like it's over.
That's it.
That's right.
The pastor has to kind of preach at an angle today. You know, today is, it's Father's Day, and, you know, we haven't had a chance actually to practice. Normally, we're able to come up, we're able to get here, we practice a lot of our things. So, I kind of throw the program at our media people and so forth right as we get here. So, bear with me if something hiccups just a little bit. Don't worry about it. This morning, we're going to start off with a couple of videos. After this first video plays, I want to get you into the second video. But I wanted to start just a little bit early here so that we can stay on time. If somebody back in the space, somebody can hit the lights, the sanctuary lights back there.
Okay.
This is our first video.
You know, there's an option for this.
I know.
What do you love about your dad?
So my dad is my superhero. He gives me strength and hope.
I love that you've never given up on me. No matter how much I was a difficult child, you just never gave up when a lot of people did.
What I love about my dad is the fact how selfless he is. He always puts everybody else first.
I love that daddy's really nice.
You know exactly how to put a smile on my face when I'm in the worst of moods. You stay up late nights and so I can talk to you, and you're there with open arms, and I can just talk to you about anything.
Dad, there are tons of things I love about you, and you know a lot of them, but I think probably the thing that I have loved most about you is how intentional you are about spending time together.
You're a hardworking man, and just your passion for all of us as a family, it's just great.
Thanks, bud.
AJ, I want you to ask your dad that question for me.
Oh, gosh, Dad.
You know.
What about me makes you proud?
What about me makes you proud?
Oh, boy. What about me makes me proud? Well, for you, what makes me proud is that we can actually work together, and that we actually get along.
Dad, mm-hmm. What about me makes you proud?
Tons of stuff. Your wit, your beauty, inner and outer beauty, your love for the Lord, love for people. Yeah, you're just an amazing young lady.
What about me makes you proud?
The way that you like to learn how to ride horses, that makes me proud of you.
How you found your way, your relationship with God, and that's what makes us proud.
I just love being a dad because I love going and watching you play sports and spending time with you and hanging out with you and raising up to be a Montreal Canadiens fan.
To me, God, Jesus was a powerful feeling. The
most important thing to me is that you have आप खुदा से प्यार करते हो कि मुझे आप पर फख्र है और अपने माँ बाप की हर एक चीज़ को आप उनका ख्याल रखते हो कि मेरे माँ बाप के क्या नीड्स हैं इसलिए मुझे आप पर ही फख्र है.
What about me makes you proud?
Everything that you are, like everything.
What about me makes you proud?
You always have a strength, an inner strength in you that is addictive. And I just love the fact that even in the moments where I feel weak, Sarah, that you actually make me feel strong and you have made me a better person.
Are you trying to make me cry? You doing a good job? No, I love you.
Starts the second video. You know, most of us, I won't say most of us, but a lot of us here in the congregation, in our fathers have gone to be with the Lord. And for them, that's a great thing. But what I want you to do today, whether, you know, if you're lucky enough that your father is still alive, find a way, some way, somehow, to touch them a voice or touch today. Let them know how much you love them. Time is short, but guess what? Memories are awesome, aren't they? As this song plays, I want you to go back in time. I want you to remember something very special about your father. If you want to, close your eyes and listen to the music. And let this song take you back to that very special moment with your father.
We traveled so far by nightfall. I'm weary, I've grown. My father's arm would slip around me and gently he'd say, my son, we're going home. Going home. I am going home. There is nothing to hold me.
Going home, I am going.
Now we can smile. Thank you. Let me get back to smile now. Okay. Join me in singing Daddy's Hands. It'll be up here on our media screen.
This morning, and Lord, there's just blessing after blessing that's bestowed upon us, and sometimes we overlook them. But Lord, we know those things that are good come from God, and we thank you for them. We also ask you, Lord, to forgive us of the things that we've done in our life, Lord, that separates us from you, that keeps us from having a complete relationship with you. Lord, we ask for forgiveness. And Father, we know that you tell us in 1 John that if we repent of our sins, you're faithful and you forgive us. And so We thank you for that forgiveness. So Lord, we just come before you today thanking you for all the wonderful blessings you give us. Thank you for each person here. Thank you for our guests, Lord, that's made a special time to come out on this day to be in the house of the Lord and to worship. And Father, today as we gather to worship, Lord, we pray that your Holy Spirit will anoint this place. And Lord, that there will be a Savior that as our praise and worship goes up, you'll enjoy the smell of the aroma of our praises to you. Father, we just ask you, Lord, to be with our country at this time. Be with the great division that, Lord, is set amongst us. Lord, we pray, God, that we just take the book and sit down and learn to love one another regardless of who they are or where they come from. Father, that we understand people are different, but we serve one God. And so, Lord, today as we have gathered here, thank you for each person that's out. Thank you for the time that you have allotted us. Lord, we just pray that this worship service will honor and glorify your holy name. We ask you to be with those of our military that serves around the world. Father, we thank you today for those fathers that are faithful to their families, that are loving and kind to their wives and their children. And Lord, we just praise you for them. We ask you, Lord, to reach out to those who have been irresponsible, to know that a father's responsibility is one of the greatest responsibilities laid before man. Father, it is a great responsibility. And we need you as our leader to help us to father in the way that you would want us to. Lord, we ask you today to be with us in this service, guide and direct each and everything that's said or done, and we'll praise you for it. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
Well, good morning and happy Father's Day to each and every one of the dads. And thank you. Oh, boy, the crowd's getting back. It's good to have each and every one. I want to commend and the rest of us need to look. Terry last week was here as our guest, and this week brought a guest. Where's our guest at? We need to look in the mirror. And so look out to somebody. There's somebody out there that needs to be in church. And so we need to be looking for those persons this morning. A couple of just quick announcements. We will continue on the Sunday morning services as this is for the foreseeable future, meaning that we won't be having Sunday school for a while. We will go back to Wednesday night services on the 8th of July. We will have them here in the auditorium. And so make your plans for that and begin our Bible studies and just have a good time of fellowship here in the Lord. And so that's the big news of the day. Any other announcement that I might have overlooked? Well, everybody speak at one time. But it is good to see everybody. It's good to see the regulars back. And so we're glad to have you. How about birthdays? Anybody going to fess up to getting older this week?
A week old.
Okay. We can celebrate that. How about anniversaries? All right. If that's all that we're doing here, we're going to say one more time, Happy Father's Day. As Jim said, if you're blessed enough to still have your father in your life, to make an effort to reach out to him and let him know that you love him.
Jim,
I got a
birthday.
I'm sorry?
It's my birthday tomorrow.
Well, you sit there and just...
Well, I always have Sam and Crip Curtis with me. They're not here.
So come on.
I'll skip it this week.
Oh, yeah. Get up.
Thanks, honey. Appreciate that.
I know it's Wednesday.
Let's stand and sing happy birthday.
Well, I'm glad you fessed up.
Cindy, check three.
Yes.
Okay, now we're okay. Turn in your hymnals. That's right, I said it. Turn in your hymnals. That's that book in the pew in front of
me. We have to actually get up and get
it. For those of you that forgot, and get some stretching exercise in. Turn in your hymnals to him, and I believe it's hymn number 96. You might tell me what the name of that song is when you get to it. For the great is our faithfulness.
That's it.
Cindy, let's sing.
There is no shadow on earth.
my versa. You're so used to not seeing people out there. I was just singing to the wall in Jerry, and it's so good to see you. So good to see you.
Amen.
And fathers, I'm going to do one more for you. And mothers, we're sorry we missed. We tried to do our best to have a good Mother's Day program, but it was good. We had a good sermon for Mother's Day, Pastor. That's one where you came up out of your shoes.
It's time to be in the Lord's house, bro.
People are looking at me wondering what I mean when I say the pastor come up out of his shoes. That's an old Baptist term we used to use when the pastor came out of his shoes. That means it was a great, great message. You know, some of those messages, if you have an opportunity, if you didn't get a chance, go back and look at some of them on YouTube if you didn't get to see them. The pastor's got some great, great messages on there. This one, gentlemen, is a, of course, it's a Mother's Day, Father's Day. It's your day. If you have children, or if you just, this one, okay, thank you. Technical difficulties. Okay, let's try. I'll make you through this one without tears, I promise.
Of life
would choose to do so, we would find a great change in our society. Lord, teach us from this teaching how we as men can do our part. And we'll praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. Max Licato, he is, if you're not familiar with him, he is a great preacher, a great writer, said this: "My father didn't do anything unusual. He only did what dads are supposed to do, be there." And that is really summarizes what is going on in our society today, is that sometimes there's failures on our own men's part to be responsible to their families. So I want to share five simple qualities with you this morning and talk about that verse 8 in just a moment. The first quality that I find that is a requirement of a man who wants to accept his responsibility is a godly father loves God. Matthew chapter 6 verse 33, the Bible says, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." The basis upon which happiness is built, priorities and relationships, I submit to each of us, is without a right relationship with God, it is impossible to be a father, to be a man, to be a person of society without having a right relationship with God. And when I say successful, I'm not only talking about the business type successful, I'm talking about just being a human being. A note stuck with me a while ago. I was talking to Joe as we came in, and I don't mean to pick on you, Joe, but I do that sometimes, and so you just have to forgive me and move on. Was this week, our sister-in-law passed away in Missouri, and we went over there for a, you know, you can't have a funeral anymore, and so, well, you can, but you can have 10 people, and so her son wanted to honor her, and so we went over to Missouri and had dinner with the family and so forth, and we came back. And Joe made the comment that if she knew the Lord, we should be happy. And you know, folks, when we lose family members, we lose loved ones and so forth, our first question that we should answer is, what is their relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ?
Amen.
And if we could answer that question and say, they knew the Lord Jesus Christ, that's going home time. Now, we're going to be sad and we're going to miss them, and that's okay. But to know that they are in the presence of God. So those of us whose father has gone on to be with the Lord, we honor them today. Because if they're in the presence of the Lord, they're in good hands.
Amen.
But if a person is running from God, and so many people are, that's the first matter you have to settle, because you cannot run from God. The Bible says if you're from the deepest bowels of the earth or the highest parts of the heavens, then God is there with you, so you really can't escape Him. Isaiah chapter 57 verse 21 says, "There is no peace, said God, to the wicked." There is no peace for the wicked. So a godly father starts by loving God. Secondly, a godly father loves his wife. Most husbands and men have a misunderstanding about true love. Many presume that the manly ego, so to speak, is about a physical attraction between man and woman, but and somewhat to a certain degree, that certainly is part of love. But Ephesians chapter 5, verses 25 through 33, and I want you to listen to this, in particular, dads and wives, if you'll listen to it, you can hold it over their head. "Husbands, love your wife as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having a spot or wrinkle or such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. For no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourished and cherished it, even as the Lord the church, for we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. For this cause shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall be joined unto his wife, and they too shall be one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let every one of you in particular so love his wife, even as himself and his wife. See that she reverence her husband. You don't get away clean, women. But the final word is, real love seeks to meet all the needs of another person. Real love isn't about me and you. It's about our relationship with other people and the Lord Jesus Christ. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 through 13, hang on to these verses because they're powerful, provides the real definition of love. This is God's word, folks. It's not, I read it from a piece of paper, but it's God's word. He says, though I speak with the tongues of men and angels and have no charity, charity translated love, I am become as a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains, and have not charity, I am nothing. And though I bestow my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not charity, it profiteth me nothing. Charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not. Charity vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up, does not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh not evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth, beareth all things, and believeth all things, hopeth all things, and endureth all things. Charity never fails. But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that is perfect to come, then what which is the part shall be done away with. When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face, now I know in part. But then I shall know even as also I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, and charity. These three, but the greatest is charity. Charity, again, translated as love. So when we think about the romantic antics and actions, it is not an abandonment of our manliness, if you will. Simple things, and boy, Betty's, you can step outside now if you want to. But this is a thought that came across my mind. We have abandoned a lot of the simple things, and sometimes we go to a restaurant or we go out into public somewhere and we see a couple come out the door and the guy takes the trouble to walk all the way around the car to open the door for his wife and close the door. These are simple things. No, I'm guilty. I'm the first to fess up. But we need to get in line with the old ways. The old way worked. But the new way is not so good. Pull out a chair at dinner. Hold her hand. do things around the house. There's a lot of things that we as men, husbands, and fathers have the responsibility. Why? Why is all that important? Not just as in being loving towards your wife or being kind to your wife, but our sons are learning from this of how to treat their wives. And their friends, one day they will treat their wives the same way that we treated their mothers. Think about that for a moment. Maybe we got to make some adjustments somewhere in our life. Not only does a godly man love God, he loves his wife, but he also loves his children. So when we look at the extent of fatherlessness in this country, There are 20 million children living in homes with no father present. That is 6% of the population of our children of this country are living in a home with no father present. And we may look at that percentage and say 6% is not a lot. If that is my child or your child, it is a lot. 6%, 20 million children living with no physical presence of the father in their home. And million more of the dads are physically present but emotionally absent. Someone said that if fatherlessness, that's a hard word, were classified as a disease, it would be an epidemic worthy of attention as a national emergency. I believe that's statistic. So love is more than the provision of just material things that we provide. We should not miss out on our children's childhood. We reminisce in our home a lot about how our children came up and talk about things that the boys did as younger children, and they're refreshing to just to look back at those things and see how far they've come and how where they are at this time. The Bible also talks about discipline our children, to do it with love. Discipline is a responsibility of parents. It's not something that we do because we just want to do it. But there is also a warning in Colossians chapter 3, verse 21. The Bible says, "Fathers, provoke not your children to anger, lest they become discouraged." And I think one of the greatest things that we need to get back to is children interpret time as love. We talk about quality time and we talk about quantity time. But children look at it as time is time. A few minutes here and a few minutes there adds up. But what about this man that we're talking about? This godly father. A godly father is a man of integrity. And I want us to refer back to this passage of scripture that Micah wrote at God's instructions. And he said three things. "He has shown thee, O man, what is good and what doth the Lord require to thee, but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with the Lord." Three things. If my life is graded around three things, that should be very simple. It all boils down to integrity. Let me help you understand what the situation was that Micah was writing about here. The nation of Israel was going through a period of time. This is 800 years before Christ. And the nation of Israel had gone through terrible kings, from Hezekiah to Ahaz to Jotham. And one just seemed to get a little bit worse than the other. And times were really hard. And now, if you look back in chapter 5 of Micah, you'll see that God is speaking to the nation of Israel. And he has given them a stern warning about what could happen if people don't begin to pay attention to what they're doing. Folks, our nation is in trouble. And if we can't see that, then we're blind in the eyes in all facets. We need to be desperately praying for the division in our nation, the racial inequality in our nation, to all these things that's going on. That's just a hubbub. Christians needs to be praying about this. But a godly father is a man of integrity. And so God instructs Micah to sit down and to write to the nation of Israel, to put these instructions out and say, "This is what I expect of you." And when you look at those three phrases, it is to do justly. That's not a complicated thing. I treat you right, you treat me right. Everybody's happy, right? So what is the problem? To walk uprightly. It just fits right in there. And so we see that God has given the nation of Israel This book was written to the nation of Israel, but it was also written to you and I. John chapter 20, verse 31, the Bible says, these words are written that you may know that Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He is the Son of God. And so we as individuals must learn to walk in the ways that God has instructed us to do. One last thing on our national leaders, and I'm talking about both sides of the fence. I'm very concerned about this situation, that when our national leaders are willing to compromise who they are for the sake of some stupid rule or something, I don't know. But I'm also concerned about when men who stand in the pulpit and declare, thus saith the Lord, and fail in their values, and fail in... We have some real problems. I did know how many pastors in past time has done wrong. I'll just leave it at that. And so we are expected to be godly men of integrity as far as our being a great father is being concerned. So God has instructed Micah to write this information down. Fifthly, godly fathers is a role model of God. God put us here, and we are His representatives to the world around us, to the society around us. And you say, I can't walk in God's shoes. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, if you study this book, if you try to practice this book, then you have the responsibility that God left you here before other people. When David was about to die, when King David was about to die, he called his son Solomon, who, of course, we know was probably the wisest man that ever lived. He called his son in and he gave him a charge. In 1 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, when the time drew near for David to die, he gave a charge to Solomon, his son. Listen to these words. I'm about to go the way of all the earth, he said. So be strong, act like a man, and observe what the Lord your God requires. Walk in obedience to Him and keep His decrees and commands, His laws and regulations as written in the law of Moses. Do this so you may prosper in all that you do, wherever you go, and the Lord may keep the promises to me. If your descendants watch how they live, and if they walk faithfully before me with all their heart and soul, you will never fail to have a successor on the throne of Israel. David said to his son Solomon, here's your instructions. Follow God's advice, do the best you can to do them, and there will always be a godly person on the throne of Israel. Folks, I want to tell you something. That we as dads today sit on the throne before our parents, before our children. They watch every move we make. They watch every turn we make. Every time we turn, how we react. Because one day they're going to be in that same spot, in that same seat. Finally, leave a legacy for your children to remember, to pass on to their children. One of the things that I enjoyed growing up was hearing my mom and dad talk about the old times. Of course, that was a long time ago, but they talked about the old times. You could just sit and listen to them. I'm afraid we're not doing that much anymore. Sharing experiences that our children can learn from our experiences. In Joel chapter 1, verse 3, the Bible says, tell it to your children, and let your children tell it to their children, and their children to the next generation. The only problem with my family is they say I tell the same story over and over. So I guess that's the way it is sometimes. But leave a legacy. Let me close with a short prayer that a Catholic monk prayed before his congregation. I read this and I wanted to read it to you. I wanted to share it with you. He prayed his prayer, a very simple prayer. Thomas Merton was his name. My Lord God, I have no idea where I'm going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain where it will all end, nor do I really know myself. And the fact that I think I'm following your will does not mean that I'm actually doing so. But I believe that desire to please you does in fact please you. And that I hope that I have a desire in all that I'm doing. Of course, sometimes we may not know for sure where we're headed, what direction we're going. But if our goal and our desire in our heart is to please God, there's a certain amount of pleasure to God in the fact that we're trying to do the best we can. My encouragement to you today is, gentlemen and ladies, live a godly life. Love God. Love your spouse. Love your family. Live with integrity. And God will be pleased. Let us pray. Father, this morning as we come before you, Lord, help us together to be those men and women that you designed us to be. You designed us with perfection. You designed us in your image. And Lord, we have failed in so many ways. But you did. You made a way for us to account for our failures. You gave us your Son, Jesus Christ. You sent him to a horrible punishment to take the sins of all mankind. Sometimes we would say thank you, and it just seems so not enough. But that's all you ask, is for us to repent of our sins and turn to you. Maybe there's someone here today, maybe some dad, that wants to make amends for the leadership they provided. Maybe there's some woman here that would like to change their life. Father, this is your invitation time, and we offer it to you and ask you, oh God, to move our hearts today to change as people. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. This morning, Jim will come and lead us in a hymn of invitation. Maybe you're here this morning, and maybe your life is not exactly what you would expect it to be or what you think God would expect it to be. This is a time that you make amends with God. God can take care of whatever your problem is in your life, or whatever your challenge is before you. He's just asking you to consider your ways. What number are we going to sing, Brother Jim?
Number 414.
414 as we stand to sing. I don't know how to deal with this COVID. I just deal with things that they are. So we have some gifts for them in. How are we going to do this, Cindy?
Okay. Okay.
All right, that's what I like. A man to stand up. So, but it's been good to be in God's house this morning. Appreciate everybody coming out. A few, slow but sure, more people are coming out, and we will gradually get back to where we're at, or where we need to be. So I encourage you to invite somebody next week. And we'll do something. We'll go to the parking lot or something. We'll do something, whatever it takes to be. So, we'll take just a moment here to get these passed out.
Almost finished.
Thanks, Cindy, for taking care of that little matter for us this week.
What is it?
It's a lantern and batteries.
When that bad storm comes and everybody says, how come we don't have any lights or anything?
With batteries. You can get a pack of batteries with them.
Mm-hmm. I have a blessing while they're doing that.
I'm
good.
Jerry
is standing up.
He's
pulling up by himself. So.
Praise the Lord. Those who may not know, Linda's children has two special needs grandchildren. And they've about a year now, I think.
Now they're 17 months old.
And they've had some complications, but God has slowly brought them up, and it's good to hear those blessings as they age. And thank you for that, and praise God for it. Anything anyone else has? Anybody else have a blessing?
Too many to name.
Too many to name. Amen. Thank God for the rain this morning. We needed that. All right. I'm getting a signal from the deacon and my wife. The offering plates are up front. So if you have an offering or a tithe, putting the offering plate up here. So everything's different. I just can't get adjusted to it. So, but thank you for reminding me.
We got lots of visitors.
We do. We have visitors, and we're thankful for that. And you get one shot at being a visitor next time you're.
That's right. You're not
part of the family. So thank you for being here. And being a part of the worship. Anything else? Yes, sir.
Yes, my name is Minister Bobby Calloway Jr. I'm from California, but I live here in Clarksville. I flew to California last year in August because my baby sister had a heart attack.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And then February 27th this year, she had a stroke in her sleep and passed away.
Oh.
I tried to fly back, but COVID-19 had all the airports shut down.
Right.
So I bought an SUV and drove back.
Oh.
And once I got here, I ended up having heart surgery on last week.
Oh, wow.
Oh, you're out. Yeah. Christ.
And I met a gentleman at the hospital, and I don't see him, but he told me about this church.
Oh.
He says that if you make a right on Dunbar Cave, it's the second church on the right before you get to the grassy hill area. And sure enough, I drove open. I'm here.
Well,
amen.
Awesome.
What was your name again, sir?
Bobby Calloway.
Bobby Calloway.
Bobby, we hope to see you
again. Yes.
Thank you.
God bless you.
Amen. You know, it's things like this that, you know, I always refer to this, and I'll get out of here in just a minute, but I always refer back to the time of Peter, James, and John. Went with Jesus to the Mount of Transfiguration. It was there. Everything was so peaceful and so glorious because God's presence was there. Peter said, let's not go back down there. Let's not go out there. That's where we go, folks. That's where we got to go. There's people that need to hear the gospel. And Jesus said, that's where we got to be, and that's where we got to go. But isn't it nice to be in the house of the Lord among God's people and just to be refreshed? Thank you, Brother Galloway, for sharing that and for being here and be in prayer for his family as they have gone through some challenging experiences. So we thank you for being here. Jerry, would you dismiss us, please?
Father God, in the name of Jesus, we bow our heads before you, Lord, at this time. We've given you thanks, praise, honor, and glory, Lord, for being our Lord and our Savior, for blessing us the way you do, Father, for providing for us to see our needs, to give us our health, Lord. When we have health issues, we know, dear Father, that when we turn to you and ask for your loving kindness, that you are there, you hear our prayers. And Lord, you restore us back to our normal places in life when it's your will and not ours. Brother Calloway has just given us a story, Lord, of the things that's happened to him and his family. And Father God, we thank you for his presence this morning in the house of the Lord. We pray for him, Lord, and pray for the family. Pray that you give them the peace, comfort, and the need to continue to have the faith grow, Lord, so that they know that they're being given the best love and things that they can possibly expect from anyone, and that's from the Lord Jesus Christ, our Lord. We're grateful, Father, for our visitors here this morning, all of them. We're always thankful, Lord, when we see our visitors walk in, and we just always pray to ourselves, Father, that we will do the right thing. Our services will impress them so that they will enjoy it and that they will come back again the following Sunday. We're happy to have Zach back with us again, Lord. We pray that you will watch over him and bless him and guide him, Lord, through these coming times. And may he walk a straight and truthful life, Lord, and serve you the best he knows how. As we're getting ready to separate and go home, Father, into other places in our lives, we pray that you'll go with us and watch over us all this week. Protect us, dear Father, from this horrible virus. And for those who have contacted it, Lord, and lived through it, we are grateful. For those who have caught it and passed on, Lord, we know that you're in control of all of that. And we know, dear Lord, that you are the one that created this. We know, dear Father, you'll be the one that will solve this problem. Make it disappear from this earth, Father, when your will is to be done. We pray for our leaders, Lord, that they'll make kind and wise decisions and they won't make it on the cuff of their brow, Lord, that they will look to you to guide them in all the decisions that they make and to help them remember, dear Lord, that they're making these decisions for all Americans and not just them, Republicans, Democrats, Independents, or whomever they may be. This is your country, Lord, because you created it. We are your people, Lord, because you created us. And Father, without you in our lives, we cannot exist. We can do no good for anybody, including ourselves. So, Father, please keep us in your loving grace. Watch over us and care for us and bring us back at our next appointed time and place. And we ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen.
Amen. God bless you.